Hola, buenas tardes. Soy Yolanda Pérez, soy la directora de BID Startup y en nombre de Banco Sabadell quería daros la bienvenida a todos y las gracias por acompañarnos hoy aquí. Vemos entre el público pues, muchos amigos del ecosistema, muchos clientes, algunas participadas, algunos inversores, incluso algunos con los que hemos coinvertido. También algunas corporaciones interesadas pues, en la innovación, en la inversión en startups. Y algunos compañeros también de Banco Sabadell. Bueno, pues eso, muchas gracias en nombre sobre todo del equipo de BID Startup, que hemos preparado con mucha ilusión este evento. Llevamos, como decía el vídeo, pues más de 4 años con este proyecto y bueno, aparte de todas las actividades que hacemos como banco y como, intentamos colaborar mucho con el ecosistema, participamos en muchos eventos, seguro que nos habéis visto, pues, de hecho estamos en toda España, apoyando todo lo que podemos, coorganizando. Y este es el único evento que organizamos en solitario, solamente BID Startup. Las BID Startup Talks o conversaciones BID Startup, pues lo que pretenden es compartir con el ecosistema un ponente muy relevante, las enseñanzas que nos puedan compartir con nosotros, pues eso, un ponente que realmente sea relevante y que nos permita llevarnos un aprendizaje esa tarde a casa, ¿no? Además, pues intentamos hacerlo en un espacio bonito como este, ¿no? Como el Círculo de Bellas Artes y compartir también con vosotros pues, una copa y el networking. A ver si tenemos suerte, el tiempo nos lo permite y podemos subir después a la terraza, que es realmente espectacular. Bueno, vosotros lo sabéis perfectamente, ¿no? Porque sois de Madrid, pero para nosotros, los que venimos de Barcelona, pues es realmente único poder estar hoy aquí. A ver si tenemos suerte, luego Elena nos contará a ver durante esta hora a ver qué pasa, pero al menos un ratito seguro que podemos salir. Pero bueno, lo realmente importante de hoy, como decía, es la persona que nos acompaña, que es Marc Toulouse. Marc Toulouse pues, es una de las personas más reconocidas en el mundo emprendedor a nivel mundial, sobre todo en el ámbito pues, de la inversión. Marc es una persona que se crió en Egipto, que estudió en Estados Unidos y hace ya 25 años que vive en Europa. Bueno, como todos sabéis, es CEO de Mangrove. Mangrove es un fondo early stage que gestiona 850 millones y que está enfocado a ideas disruptivas pues, en todo el mundo, pero principalmente en Europa. En España ha hecho ya algunas inversiones como, pues, como Badi o como Wallapop, o más recientemente Redpoints. Redpoints es una participada nuestra de BID Startup y bueno, pues por eso conocemos a Marc. Y hemos podido ver también cómo él se involucra pues con los emprendedores apasionados, él le gusta apoyarles. Él es conocido sobre todo, aunque ha invertido en muchísimas compañías, es conocido sobre todo por ser uno de los primeros inversores de Skype, no hace falta que diga nada de Skype, también de otras empresas como Wix, ¿no? Wix está en el Nasdaq, cotiza en el Nasdaq con una valoración de unos 4 billones de dólares y Marc es el presidente de Wix, es decir, que continúa desde sus inicios, ha continuado involucrado en su desarrollo bueno, hasta hoy. Entonces, bueno, pues lo que queríamos era que compartiera con nosotros pues todo lo que ha aprendido estos años acompañando estas compañías de crecimientos tan exponenciales y tan espectaculares. Y bueno, pues es para esto, para lo que lo hemos invitado, ¿no? Básicamente, que nos explique qué es lo que marca la diferencia, ¿no? Thanks for joining us today here, Marc. I'm switching into English. Marc speaks perfectly Spanish and he understands everything, so that's why I was talking in Spanish. Thanks for being here today in Madrid. It's really a honor for us having you here. The title of your talk is How to Achieve a Great Growth Trajectory, a really exciting subject for all of us. So, well, we are really anxious about knowing more about that. Please come to the stage and, well, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Good evening, Madrid. I feel like a rock star. In any event, it's an absolute pleasure to be here with you this evening, and I will try my best to make it worth your time. I believe that when you come to events like this, you need to take something away from it. And my objective is to share with you some of the things that I've seen in companies in the past, what has worked, mostly what's worked. I may give you some things about what has not worked, but it's mostly about what is it you need to do to build a successful company. Now, before I do that, let me first of all congratulate B Startup. The ecosystem that we find in Spain today, B Startup is one of the key players, of course. There are others, and I'll be kind enough not to mention them here. But the work that B Startup is doing is fundamentally important to the ecosystem of startups in Spain. And it's fundamental because an ecosystem needs, of course, people like you, entrepreneurs. It needs people like me, finance people. And it needs the third leg of it, which is a number of enablers to make it happen. This is the key of what happened in Silicon Valley. It's the key of what happens in a number of cities outside of Spain. We're beginning to see that dynamic take place both in Madrid and in Barcelona. So the world that I discovered when I created Mangrove almost 18 years ago was more akin to a desert. There were very few investors, very few entrepreneurs, and certainly even less enablers. And so thank you very much for having me and giving me the opportunity to spend, you know, some time with you here this evening. Now, my background would not naturally have predisposed me to do what I do today. I studied history in university. During 4 years of my studies at university, every single person told me, "What are you going to do with a history degree?" At the time, I thought history was pretty cool. And then my parents in the fourth year said, "What are you going to do with a history degree?" And I actually started thinking, there's not a whole lot I can do with a history degree, because the natural course of things, if you study history, is to go teach somewhere. And that became one of the great lessons of my life, is what you study in university does not at all need to be what you ultimately become, right? What you study in history, in university, I'm sorry, is really all about setting up a thinking process so that you can face the challenges of the world later on. Now, here's some good news, right? The good news is anybody who's below 40 years old, here, hopefully most of you, but if not, anybody who's below 40, there is a very high likelihood that you will live way past 100 years of age. If you're above 40, like me, we are the last generation that will not benefit from genomics. Genomics is this fantastic new revolution that is very, very close. And it's essentially the ability that we now begin to see that we will be able to break down your DNA and recode your genomes and your genes. And so if you have a particular gene that is a cancer gene, we're going to be able to go in there and say, turn it off. That revolution is happening now. We'll begin seeing it hit the market in about 10 to 15 years. But old people like me, it's too late. So my comments are now dedicated towards the younger people. So the good news is, you studied history perhaps in university, you are likely to have 3 or 4 careers in your life. So what doesn't matter is what you learned in university. Had you learned how to code in university, and that would have been your passion, here's some bad news for you. Within 10 years, coding skills will no longer be required, because artificial intelligence is going to make it so that I will largely be able to talk into something, and the code will automatically be written. Now, here's where engineers all tell me, that's not true, and you're crazy, and everything. No, I'm absolutely right. And the reason I know I'm right is I've seen code generation generating engines already. We already have largely available libraries that you can go and pick large pieces of code to execute a certain amount of tasks. Now, here's the sad part about engineers. All they have studied is engineering. And most psychological studies are quite clear about they have an inability and a difficulty dealing with complex thought problems. You get this if you studied history. Of course, I didn't know this when I studied history. And so, as I said, I was not predisposed to do the job that I do today. And the job I do today is, frankly, reasonably easy. I see about 2,000 companies a year. When I say I, of course, I speak myself and my colleagues in Mangrove. We see about 2,000 companies a year, and we pick six that we want to invest in. And so, in essence, what I have had to develop over my life is a crystal ball. And that crystal ball has to allow me to think about the future. That future being about 10 years out, right? I'm investing now, hoping that within 10 years, the company that I have financed is going to be interesting and successful. Because most startups today take 10 years to reach their critical mass. And I'll tell you a story. I was very fortunate in one of my early investments in Skype. I invested in it in 2003, and I sold it to eBay in 2005, 2 years later, for $3 billion. So that's an exception. Put that aside for a moment, right? That's an absolute exception. The more likely cause is 10-year journey that you have to go along. And so that crystal ball becomes, man, so important. And that crystal ball is the same one that entrepreneurs have to have. When you go down the path of thinking, where do I want to spend the next 10 years of my life? Then you also need to have a crystal ball. The advantage I have is I see 2,000 ideas every year. You don't. And so that's one of the great challenges that you have. And so what I thought I would start off my talk with you today is around what are the minimum requirements just to be a decent entrepreneur. I don't mean creating Skype or creating Wix and some of these other things, right? What is it you need? And this is my experience. I don't have all the answers, I will freely admit to that. I have a lot of experience. But the minimum requirements, let me start off with one that I'm constantly flabbergasted with when I meet entrepreneurs. How easy is it for you to articulate your business proposition? My experience is, out of the 2,000 deals I see a year, 1,975 cannot do a good job at articulating in a very simple way what they do. People start talking, and before you know it, I'm like, I don't understand what the hell you're talking about. And I'm going to get to this in a second, but the minimum requirement to succeed is clarity of thought and clarity of expression. So here's the good news. Skype, it was free calling. Boy, that's pretty clear. At Wix, where I'm chairman, it's about free websites. It's pretty clear. But 1,975 out of 2,000 I see are not clear. And that's because they don't take the time to distill their message into a very simple thing to say. Most of these are engineers anyway, right? So they're complex minds, and they get lost in their own complexity. But they don't take the time to be able to talk about it in a very simple way. So the first lesson I have is that I learned over this time is articulate what you do and who you are in such a simple way that everybody goes, yeah, I get it. In my home, my acid test is my 75-year-old mother on the phone. I call her up and I say, I've just invested in this really cool company. Here's what it does. And if she goes, oh, that's cool, I know I might have a winner. Often she says, honey, I don't understand. How's your brother? But I'm giving you a very basic example of what happens every single day. Now think about it. If you can't convince your mother, who's willing to give me all the benefits of the world, and I also have two children, which I do the same thing on, and if I can't convince them, how the hell do you think I'm going to convince anybody else that this is a good deal? So clarity of thought really is an important one. The second one on the internet, and my comments today are really focused around internet, of course, right? I'm a big fan of entrepreneurship in all the forms that it takes, but professionally I invest only in internet and software companies. And so the second one is be super focused on product. Product is everything. And I mean simplicity of product, right? We talk in our firm about a frictionless product. How do you take friction out of the usage case? And you would be surprised how many people will tell me, no, but we put this feature in there because of this. And I'm like, well, who cares about it? Because if my 75-year-old mother or my 16-year-old son struggles to get to the next step of your sign-up process because you wanted something in there, well, frankly, nobody is going to use your product. So being focused on product is so important, and it's a very, very rare skill. So of the 2,000 business plans that we look at every year, I would say we would be lucky if we found 50 great product people. It is the skill that allowed us to make Skype successful way back when, by the way, Skype didn't invent voice over IP, right? There were many players before, including a product from Apple, a product from Google, a number of other products. But Skype had a product guy who understood that the experience of calling was okay, but what really mattered was when you download the app, they were able to get through firewalls in a way that nobody had been able to do it before. So the experience was so easy. And the same thing is at Wix. When you go and actually build a website on Wix, it's such an easy process. A 12-year-old could do it. My mother has built a website on Wix, and she's 75. And the reason they have success is because their product skills are so great. So product is kind of the second one. The third one is passion, right? And so I'm giving you these very quickly. Passion sounds like, you know, oh, well, of course, we all have passion. Remember this. A startup is a 10-year journey. A tech startup, if you're going to be very good, is 6 days a week, 14 hours a day. Starting a company is not a project. It's the word I hate the most. It's a way of life. You better be passionate about the problem you're trying to solve. If you're not passionate, you will become bored, your wife will divorce you, or your husband will divorce you, because you're spending too much time and you're not happy yourself. So I really want you to remember, unless you have that passion for the idea that you're trying to solve, find another idea. Because it comes across to me as an investor very, very quickly. The fourth one is be humble. In English, we have an expression, you know what you know, you don't know what you don't know. And all the great entrepreneurs that I have been involved with, they fundamentally understand their limits. They hire great people who are better than them. That takes a lot, right? You're the founder of a company. You hire people more intelligent than you. It's a bit of an uncomfortable environment, but it's the environment required to challenge you, but more importantly, to solve your personal discrepancies. I have many. I will admit to none of them today, but I hire great people at Mangrove, and I hire great people in my companies because I don't have all the answers. I never have. So make sure that you are humble in how you build your company, in how you bring people on board, how you bring advisors on board, and do that. And the last one of my basic rules is you need to be a contrarian, right? The reason you're launching a startup is because you see a hole in an industry, or you see an opportunity to change incumbents, right? So today, I get to the airport, I open a newspaper, I forget even which one it is, and the title was, you know, three banks are demanding that there's regulation for fintech startups. I mean, of course, incumbents are going to do this. These are some of the biggest banks in Spain whose only message is, we need more regulation to stop the startups. So here's something I want to tell you. There is absolutely no reason why large incumbent industries, whether it's banks or telecoms or anything, ever innovate. Innovation hurts margins. For any of you who get internet connectivity here in Spain, you will know how Telefónica rips you off constantly. The cost of the internet access here is insane. And the cost of telephony is insane. And that is because you have three incumbents who kind of carve up the market and who have no interest in any way, shape, or form. My point of all this is not to rile on telecoms, which I have notoriously done all my life. It's to tell you that if you're going to start a startup, you need to be a contrarian to go against people like this. There are big industries and they will do everything that they can. When we were doing Skype in the US, we had all the telcos on our back. And it was all around the equivalent of the 112 number, the emergency number, right? They wanted to shut us down because on the internet you couldn't dial 112. It was just a bullshit example for them to try and get in our way. And so you need to be this contrarian, right? And so those are like the five basic rules. Look at yourself in the mirror if you're going to start a company and tell yourself, is my identity and my pitch clear enough that I can convince my mother and my kids? Like, can you do it in like one sentence? Tomorrow morning when you get up, try it. Convince yourself. I do that a lot. I talk to myself a lot. The second one, as I said, is product focus. The third, passion. The next one, be humble. And the next, be a contrarian. So these are great, like, basic rules just to get starting. If you do that, I'm willing to talk to you. If you can satisfy those five criteria, right? Good. I got this guy here telling me he wants to talk to me. That's cool. Now, that's all been interesting, but so far you probably haven't learned a whole lot, right? Nice words and everything. What I'm going to give you next is not just the basics of what you have to do to even begin to be successful, but some of the things that have worked in my best companies, what I call key to their success. And if you do these, I'm sure you can be very successful too. One out of five in no order of priority. Gender diversification. For those of you who know me, it's one of my pet peeves. I tweet a lot about it. I talk a lot about it. And a lot of people ask me, why do you make this such a big deal? Yeah, of course, it's in the press. And in the US, they're all crazy about this, constantly talking about this stuff. But I talk about it because I know for a fact that it works. I have seen it work in all of my best companies. Let me focus on Wix for a moment. So Wix is about $500 million in revenue, 2,000 employees, $4 billion or so on the NASDAQ. We have 42% women in the company. 42. By any measure, that is exceptional. Even by US standards, where on the average in tech, you're at about 22%. Now, we didn't start off doing this at Wix because we had some kind of moral obligation to do it. At Wix and all my other companies, we did it because we wanted to hire the best people. And when we decided we wanted to hire the best people, we began realizing as we were going through the process, that's the only thing that mattered. Was the best people. Not the people who looked like me, not the people who repeated what I wanted them to repeat. Because when you go after hiring the best people, you will very often get people who don't think like you. And here's something we all know, but women think very differently than men. Like, super differently, right? There's this prism through which they look at life, and sometimes I go, I just don't get it. I have a wife and a daughter, so I live this at home sometimes in my own arguments, but I've seen it in product design. So think about this. At Wix, 50% of our customers, we have 125 million customers around the world. Let's call them users, right? Bill Gates prefers the word users if they're free. 125 million, 50% of women. So how logical would it be for this thing to be built by men on a product where font makes a big difference, color makes a big difference? I wouldn't say men are the best at both of those two things, right? So our product team at Wix is very, very well balanced, and so we know fundamentally it works. Now, I'm not saying it is the only key to success, but it is the key to success in all of my current very successful companies. We have, on the lowest point, 35% women. On the highest point, Wix, 42%. So gender diversity is not something you just read about in the press. It's something that you, as a business leader, you set the tone for it to happen in your organization, not because, if you're a man, your wife said you have to do it, but because Mark today told you that it works in the internet world. It truly does work. I have seen it. When you pick a color for a website, men pick typically colors they like. But you have to think, who is going to be visiting this website? And so if you're a hairdresser, we have many, many hairdressers who are using Wix, you can't have a manly color on a website. And so we realized at Wix that our user experience was pretty good. Our initial product was all about a template-driven product. So think of it as PowerPoint-like, right? But we realized that a lot of our users were coming on board and they just weren't building websites. And part of that is because they had this anxiety moment after they signed up. That anxiety moment was, oh man, what color and what font should I use? Now, I encourage you guys to build a website, of course, with Wix, but I encourage you to try in that. You'll see. It's not obvious. You get all these fonts and all these colors, and you go, oof. Like for Mangrove, what color should it be? It's hard to tell. And so luckily at Wix, we had our designers at Wix are 65% women, so we knew we would get good colors for women. So we built a product called Wix ADI. It's an artificial intelligence product that takes this moment of anxiety away. And you answer 5 questions, including what gender you are, and it produces a website for you matching what women like and what men like. You need to embrace the fact that we're different, not fight it. We call it at Mangrove complementary diversity, right? Complementary divergence. We're very different. It creates management problems, for sure, in your company. Because we just look at the world differently. But the power of diversity in gender is huge, and it is one of the 2 things that when I invest in a company, I insist upon happening. The second one is equity ownership for all. This is not something that Spain does very well. I can tell you here. At Wix, we have 2,000 employees. We have 200 millionaires in dollars. This is how generous we have been with the equity of the company. After all, it's the employees who largely contribute to making this thing successful. Now, the trade-off with options is, if you want options, you get less salary, right? This is kind of this thing that moves around like this. And I believe it is what's made Wix successful, and I believe it's what has made successful all of our other companies. You must, and maybe you don't want to give equity to every single employee, but having a very broad base of equity ownership, where you can look at yourself and say, if I'm worth $100 million, $500 million, $1 billion, here's how many people are going to be wealthy because of me, who can buy an apartment or buy a house because they worked in this company. It makes a huge amount of difference. Equity ownership is something, when I visit Europe, I realize that in the north, people are beginning to understand that this is important. And the further south I come, the less open-minded people are. And I'll tell you a story. I have a friend of mine, he lives in Barcelona. He's the ex-founder of a company called Trovit. He sold his company for like 80 million euros a number of years ago. None of his employees had any options. So first of all, do you think they have a fond memory of him? They all think he's a bastard. He might have been a nice guy, but they didn't get anything except a salary. So just for that, I don't think I'd like to have that memory of myself as a boss. Just for that. But then he told me something funny. He told me, Mark, I started a new company. I heard what you said about options, and I hired my first 10 or 20 employees, I forget what it was, and one day I came in and talked to them about the stock option plan. And they kind of looked at me like I was from Mars, he says. And some of them even said, hey, listen, we don't have time for this. We need to make some phone calls. Now, this is exactly what has made Silicon Valley very successful, is the stock option program. So the responsibility when I invest in a Spanish company is making sure that employees understand that if you join my company, there will be a trade-off on salary against options because I want you to love me when we're very successful. So options are the second one where, frankly, for me, it's a non-negotiable item. You must push it down to your employees. It always sounds great not to do it because you own a big chunk of equity, but as you build your business, frankly, I think that doesn't work so good. The third one, and this is one that I am very attached to, is world-class marketing skills. So I am flabbergasted every time I meet internet entrepreneurs who mostly, largely are engineers starting their businesses. And these people, when I talk to them about marketing, they go, huh? Think about, we're building a great product. And I said, yeah, but how are people going to know about your product? And so herein lies one of the great lessons of life. And it's a life, most of the time, the internet in the real world is very different. People say, oh, there's internet rules and there's like real world rules. Well, in the context of marketing, that's not true. Unless your company is Facebook, Skype, Google, right? So I hope you all have one of those, right? But the likelihood is you won't. 99% of all the companies out there require marketing to get known. So at Skype, we spent less than $50,000 on marketing our entire life. At Wix, we spend $150 million every year on marketing. Now, Wix is a fantastic product. But unless I tell people about it, how are they ever going to know it's such a great product? You know, we are sponsors of Manchester City, New York Yankees. We do all sorts of stuff so people, that kind of sounds like the real world, right? And so my challenge to particularly engineering back educated entrepreneurs is, it's really great that you want to build a great product, but when you start your company, make sure that you are hiring great people or co-founding it with people who are going to be able to market it very well. And here's why. Between 40 and 50% of all your expenditures in an internet company is marketing. Maybe you don't think it's marketing, and you're thinking it's called Google SEO, or you're thinking it's called Facebook. And this is the great lie that those two companies have put out there. Start your company, we'll do the marketing for you, right? Advertise on Facebook and life will be great. Buy some SEO on Google and you are in great shape. The reality, of course, could not be further from the truth. You will lose all your money if you do that. There is an amazing art to performance marketing. And unless you know how to deal with performance marketing from day one, you will fail. I have seen many, many, many companies started by engineers or historians or others who didn't know anything about marketing and who figured, you know what, this is one of those soft skills I can learn along the way. You cannot learn performance marketing along the way. And we refuse, as an investment firm, for you to try to learn it with my money. Right? You have a great product, we're going to back you, and if you don't have great marketing people on board, we're going to hire them together, but you will get great marketing people. And so, in the US, whenever you talk about a startup, people say, how many employees do you have? Oh, how many of those are engineers, right? Because that's kind of what the last 10 years has been all about. I refuse to answer that question at Wix. Because Wix would never be a success without its marketing department. We have 250 people in our marketing department who spend $150 million every year making sure you know who we are. And when you think about website building, you're first, and it's hard because it's a noisy place out there. Think about it. You start your little company, you got a great product. How is anybody ever going to know about you? It's noisy. They don't have the benefit of standing here in front of you and telling how great their product is, right? So marketing is that skill. Unless you have it, you're not going to do particularly well. Let's see. Four is what I call the art of storytelling. Storytelling is the most underrated skill that I have ever seen. Storytelling is about captivating your audience, about grabbing them by the throat and say, "Listen to me now because I have something interesting to tell you." You know, we've all sat in front of our TV, turned on the television to start a movie, and you know after the first 5 minutes it's a shitty movie. You just know it. Because those first 5 minutes were just not captivating to you. In a noisy world, unless I can captivate your attention immediately like this, somebody else will be on stage right after me captivating you. And so it's a constant competition. It's even more of a competition if you're trying to fundraise, raise capital, right? Heck, investors like me, we want a dream. I want another Skype. I want another Wix. I'll tell you a little secret why I want that. It's because after I sold Skype, for 6 years after that, my son, who was now 15, he was 9 at the time, kept telling me, "Man, I'm tired of hearing about Skype. Don't you have something else?" I have my own kid, you know? And I kept telling him, "I got this great thing. It's called Wix and all this stuff." And he kept believing me. And eventually, of course, I was fortunate it worked out well. But storytelling is really about that skill. Now, storytelling is not something that you walk up here on stage and start talking about. Telling a story requires a script. When I meet, you know, many of these 2,000 entrepreneurs that come to visit me at Mangrove, and we ask them, "So how long did you prepare for this presentation? You know, and did you rehearse it a lot?" No, "I kind of went over it on the plane over here." I'm like, "You're an idiot." You have an opportunity to come and pitch a venture capital firm. It's hard enough to get a meeting, right? 2,000. Not everybody gets a meeting, right? And so if in that meeting you are not impressive like this, you can walk out of the door, "I forgot you" the next day. No different than a movie. I mean, I fall asleep in movies sometimes. My wife insists I go to, you know? Because I know I'm not going to like it, but I go because, you know, I love her. In the startup world, I don't love you. I have 6 others I'm looking for that I'm going to love more. So the question you have to ask yourself is, how good is your script? How much have you practiced that script? Because I can tell you something. When I come and speak in front of you, I practice a lot. And I'll tell you a story. I have a friend of mine. He's an actor in Hollywood. And he came and spoke to, every year Mangrove organizes the 10 best CEOs that we have. Completely arbitrary, right? I decide who the best are. But we bring them together, and it's every year a different city. We've done it in Madrid in the past, and Venice, and all these places. Last year we did it in Barcelona. And my 10 best CEOs, 8 of which are engineers. And the theme, I always have a theme. Last year's theme was storytelling. 8 of them called me up and says, "What are you talking about? Like, how's that relevant to me?" I said, "Don't worry, you know, come and we'll figure it out together." So my actor friend, who's been in a number of movies, a number of TV series, I invite him to come and talk to these folks. And he gets up, and for 45 minutes, he gives a speech, and they're all like, oh, he's awesome. Now, he's an actor, right? He does this for a living. And they ask him, wow, you speak so well. And he says, it's because I've practiced for 4 days to be here in front of you, so that when I do that, you go, wow, I want you to love me. When you're in a startup, you first want investors to love you so they write you a check, right? But more importantly, you want the world to love you so that they use your product. So unless you know how to tell a story well, I can assure you, you will be forgotten as quick as anything. My advice is write a script, practice 1,000 times in front of your mirror. It's the most important thing you do. You could have a shitty deck of slides, but if your story is great, we're going to be enthralled, right? We're going to sit here and listen and talk, and we're going to be very interested in engaging with you. So storytelling is fundamentally important. The last one I will tell you that one of the things I recognize in every single startup that's great is they understand the need for speed, okay? You're in the internet today. Remember, we have this thing called dog years, right? I have a dog, he's 10 years old. He's kind of like a 70-year-old person. One dog year is seven human years, right? Well, we have the internet version of that as well, right? One internet year is worth like 10 real years. And unless you're prepared to work fast, here's what's going to happen to you. You work nice and slowly, you start getting some traction in the market, with a service particularly, and all of a sudden, copycats are everywhere. I'm the shareholder in a company that operates in Spain called Job Today. Job Today is a company that gives blue-collar workers the opportunity to find jobs through an app. They invented the model. In Europe, we now have 20 copycats. 20. And we thought we were fast. So speed is an unbelievably important thing when you're thinking about this. And I tell you this because you have you have capital in the market to help you grow fast. But it's a mindset, right? The mindset is, how quickly are you going to get this done? You have to spend time getting your product right, right? So I have one of my companies I funded happened to be in Madrid today, shooting for something very secretive. But I'll tell you about it. What's the name of the show? Rosa. You guys know that show? Ana Rosa. You guys know that show? Tomorrow at 10:30, please watch it. This guy's going to be on it. But he has a great product. It's called Safe 365. It's about how you help elderly people stay in touch with their parents. And, you know, I'm on his back all the time. You got to do it fast. You got to do it better. Don't sleep. Because what's going to happen is somebody somewhere is going to go, hey, that thing looks pretty good. It's working. And they're going to copy exactly what he's doing. I mean, look at this. Snapchat, the inventor of stories, is being killed by Facebook, right? Snapchat's a shitty company in any event, right? Just poorly managed, not a great product company. But they invented stories. And now Facebook is absolutely crushing them on stories. And that's because Snap didn't evolve fast enough to make sure they kept ahead of everybody else, right? So speed is fundamentally important. It's a mindset. The other ones are tools to success, right? Gender equality, equity, marketing, storytelling. But speed is a mindset. It's what you have in here. Am I ready for speed? Okay. So those are some of the things that I have seen in companies that have been successful, right? Is all these little things helped to make this company special. I thought I would also perhaps share with you today some of the areas that we're thinking about as investors. Like, where is it hot, right? What's the future made up of? And so I will tell you two things that get me particularly excited right now is everything in healthcare. So anybody who's doing anything in healthcare, software-based, I'm interested, right? And this is why. The healthcare market in the world is broken. Software is going to lead a huge revolution in healthcare, because artificial intelligence is going to allow us to manipulate data and do things well. And the other one is products for an elderly generation. How do you deal with old people? Because here's something I didn't know. Old people, 65 plus, right? Old people want products that don't make them look old. How did I discover this? You see all these little anecdotes of life, right? My father was struggling with his telephone. He couldn't see the numbers on the phone. So I bought him a big phone, like with big numbers. And I gave it to him very confidently that I had solved his problem. And he looked at me, he says, "What the hell is that?" I said, "Well, it's your new phone." He said, "It makes me look like an old man." He says, "I may be an old man, but I don't want to look like one." And so what it does is if you're going to focus products, companies on building products for older people, well, you got to do it in a way that they don't feel particularly bad about it, right? So those are two areas that I am particularly interested in. And then, of course, what we have is the great artificial intelligence revolution coming right now. AI or machine learning, or pick whatever name you want to put to it. It's coming in a big way. It's going to have a massive impact on everything that we do. I'm not going to tell you what sectors, but what I'm going to tell you is you're going to have moral questions around how do you deal with this. This is going to be more a question of morality than it's a question of technology, right? You can build expert systems, you can do all sorts of things, but the data that you're going to be able to take out of it is going to be questionable on how it's being used. And as a society, you want to think about that. You want to think about what is acceptable, what is tolerable in this funky world where technology believes they can do anything. And I mentioned before genomics, which is kind of that next one over there. You know, when I can go in and turn off the cancer cell in your body, that same procedure can say to me, I want big hands in my child so he can be a basketball player. So as we head over the next 15, 20 years in genomics, you will notice that, again, the problems will no longer be one of tech, but it's going to be one of society. How do we as a human race accept that we have these choices to make, and where are the boundaries with which we make them? Both artificial intelligence and genomics will have this issue. Artificial intelligence, because we can just, you know, computers can make decisions so much faster, pardon me, and iterate so much faster than a human, that over time our ability to compete with them is going to be gone. And we have to be ready for that. I think in most areas, I'm extremely optimistic about it. You know, I have funded a company in a healthcare space called K-Health. What they've done is they have 2 billion medical incidents around people, and they're able to cut data across all sorts of ways, and so that when you download their app and you say, hey, I'm Enrique, I'm so high, here's my weight and everything, and I have a headache, K is the name of the product, they interact with you and say, so where does it hurt? How does it feel? They do things like doctors would do. But because they have 2 billion medical incidents, they can immediately say, aha, in my database is like 500,000 people who had the same symptoms as you. And this is how they were treated, and this is what the diagnosis was. So I believe in the next 15 to 20 years, GPs, general practitioners, are likely to largely be out of business. Now, when I say this, this is a prediction. Many people tell me, come on, you know, people always want to talk to a human, that compassion, you know? I can't remember the last time my general practitioner was compassionate with me. Maybe it's my character. But in general, they kind of poke you around a bit and they go, I think you have this, take this pill and come back in a month if it didn't work. That doesn't sound particularly compassionate to me. So the human element of all of these evolutions is sometimes, in fact, many cases, largely overvalued. Of course, we all have a story of a doctor that we remember fondly because he or she was particularly nice. But the majority of us will not have that experience in our lives. And so think of artificial intelligence and genomics as your two greatest problems. The more you read up on it, the more you get educated on this particular subject, the more intelligent you will be for yourself on how you handle these things. But of course, in this conundrum of questions lies tremendous opportunities to build businesses that satisfy some of these demands. And therein lies your challenge. What company are you going to build? What dream do you have? What problem do you want to solve? In 2018, in Spain, you have an ecosystem that is fundamentally strong enough to provide you financing, partners, ideas. And if you don't like Madrid or if you don't like Barcelona, you can always go live in Berlin, right? You're not stuck here. There is no reason in a world that is flat that you would not necessarily say, let me go somewhere else. Now, in my closing remarks, I want you to know that Europe has become, you know, one of the places where innovation is happening. You no longer have to move to Silicon Valley. Skype was the first great example of that. We built Skype in Estonia, in Tallinn, of all places. And from there, we spread across the world. And Europe today has structures to support entrepreneurs everywhere. There's a vibrant, and quite deep environment of investors who are willing to participate in all sorts of different projects. So there's never been a better time in Europe to start a company, ever. We're even getting past this European problem of accepting failure. I would always prefer to fund somebody who's failed once. Somebody else has paid for their mistake or their learning, right? And there's nothing wrong with failure as long as what they're talking about and their vision is really strong enough of where they want to go. So that is really the few things I wanted to say today. I'm happy to answer some questions if you think I can answer anything of use to you. My premise is I don't know everything. I've seen a lot in the world. I've been very fortunate to be involved with great entrepreneurs who really were so passionate about what they wanted to build that they really prepared to give up everything to make that happen. Now, lastly, but very importantly, venture capitalists like me, my particular firm, we're only interested in companies who really want to grow very big. But that doesn't mean that even if you want to grow a small business, it's a great business to have. One of my best friends has a company and he has 6 employees. The company's revenue is $3 million a year. He as a founder makes $1 million per year and he's extremely happy. And what he does is a Visual Basic editing tool. Dumb as hell. But man, I'm so happy for him. It's not a business that I would fund. So when I talk about all these things about growing big and growing, this is really self-centered for me. I want people who want to do that. But entrepreneurship really is the great journey. Whether you do it in a big way or in a way just to keep yourself where you are, it is the journey that gives you the decision on your life. Remember, corporates, there's no loyalty left anymore. Governments, to you, there's no loyalty anymore. Public servants everywhere will tell you that. They're cutting their rights left and right. And so today, if you want to control what you're doing, if you want to control your own destiny, the thing you need to do is start a company. It doesn't have to be Skype. It has to be enough so that you can live the life you want to live. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark, for coming, for that amazing talk with us and for sharing with us not only your professional and your personal experience, but also for all the advice you have given us from different points of view, for entrepreneurs, for investors, and for the VCs. It has been really great to have you here with us once again with VIA Startup Talks. I hope everybody has enjoyed as much as I have. Y ahora yo creo, también utilizando el español, que vamos a dar paso a turno de preguntas. Os iremos pasando el micrófono y os agradeceríamos que dijerais vuestro nombre o al menos os presentéis y tratemos de ser breves para intentar dar la oportunidad a varias personas. No sé por dónde empezamos.
I can hear you, it's fine.
Yes. So congratulations for the speech. Yeah, I think it's amazing. So I see you've practiced before coming. I have a couple of questions. One is about storytelling.
Yeah.
What happens when you go with your story and then you get a Q&A, tough Q&A? How you prepare that? And second question is about the trends that you mentioned. I missed blockchain. Do you have an opinion on that?
That's a lot of questions. So obviously, you know, you practice your storytelling a lot, and in practicing, you get smarter about the questions people ask you. I very rarely get surprised with questions anymore because I also prepare the type of questions people might ask you. If you're pitching investors, those questions are quite simple and basic because we're simple and basic people, right? Very simpletons. We want to know it can be big, and we want to know the market size and all these silly little other things. But I think the number one thing is just impressing. If you impress less on the Q&A, people will give you a pass on that because, it was tough and we're not very nice and they were under pressure. But if you can just explode on the storytelling, you know, I always give somebody the benefit of the doubt when we go through questions because if they were great in their storytelling. Because I feel it's disrespectful to me when they come unprepared. It's a bit if I had come here to you, then I wouldn't have been this, and you know, you'd be like, why am I wasting my time here, you know? I mean, I had to come, it's 7:45 at night. I know in Madrid you eat late, but still, it's 7:45 at night. You could be with your family instead of listening to me now, or your boyfriend or your husband or whatever. But the reality is it's about respect as well. So the first answer is don't worry about that. Be good on the first piece, right? On trends, of course, how can you not talk about blockchain, cryptocurrencies, and all those type of things? We think of that in three very distinct buckets, right? You have blockchain, which is an enabling technology. In the old days, we used to call that distributed databases, distributed ledgers, so it's all kind of the same. But it's essentially all about how do I make sure that data is not easily intercepted and stolen by storing it into a number of different places, and I have the algorithm to bring it back. And we think there's great opportunities to invest in that as well. The second piece you hear is about cryptocurrencies, Bitcoin, Ethereum, all these kind of things, right? Where I remember all my friends saying, did you buy any Bitcoins? Oh man, you're gonna be rich, you know? And by the time I realized how big it was probably $15,000 per Bitcoin. If I bought it, I'd lost a lot of money by now. But we don't speculate on volatile things like that. And the last one typically put in all of that is the ICO market, right? The tokens, the coin offerings. That was a great trend in 2017. 2018, the world is a lot harder for ICOs because in 2017, they essentially came to you with an idea, give me free money, and I've met a number of entrepreneurs trying to do ICOs. Here's usually how the conversation goes, right? They come to me and they say, oh, I got this great vision. So far, so good, right? I'm like, great. So they tell me about the vision and they said, we're not raising any capital, and so you're not gonna get any equity in the business. I go, ooh. And they say, but you're going to get tokens or coins, right? And I'm like, oh, that's great. I'm going to get tokens and coins. And I said, how do those tokens gain value? Now, I will tell you, 99% of the time, the answer is, I don't understand the question. I'm like, well, how do I make money in this relationship? I don't understand the question. I'm like, I want you to understand that venture capitalists, we also have investors who want to make money. And so we think of our relationship with entrepreneurs as a symbiotic relationship where we both have to make money. So ICOs is, I think, a trend. It needs to be done a little better. I think there's going to be some very successful ones, but it's highly speculative today. And I prefer to speculate on your idea than on some, you know, some crazy coin. Okay?
It's Guillermo Serrano from Checkpoint Partners. Thank you for being here today in Madrid.
Sure.
Actually, the question was exactly about what you just said. It's about how do you make money?
Yeah.
And if you can share with us a little bit about how do you plan for exits? What's the end of the road for you? How long does it take you to build a business, help a business grow?
Yeah.
And finally, sell it to somebody else.
Okay.
And who is that somebody else?
Yeah. So, you know, obviously when we use our crystal ball and we look at it and say, where are the type of companies we want to invest? One of the things we look at hard is, you know, how good is the founder of that company or how good is she at selling themselves first to us, but then ultimately to a potential buyer because it's still about selling yourself. So that becomes for us an important criterion. But what we try to do is when we invest is to begin to think about who are the type of buyers of the company. You know, 9 times out of 10, our list is wrong. Because a buyer today, it'll be very different tomorrow. Okay, and so what we do is we constantly have conversations with our entrepreneurs and say, you know, depending on how the company is growing, pardon me, if it's growing very fast, it's fine. But, you know, if it's not growing so fast, you have to start thinking about one day you sell. You know, tech companies are a bit like that can of peas that you buy at the supermarket. There is an end date to it. Tech companies don't live forever. Eventually, your technology is old and nobody wants it. Right, so you have to be able to pick the right cycle in which, and that's where I think we're very good at helping our entrepreneurs. We're also helpful in telling them not to sell. That happens rarely, right? But in 2011, do you guys know a company called Vistaprint? Yeah, you know it, right? So the CEO is a good friend of mine, the founder is a good friend of mine, and I introduced him to a small company called Wix at the time, and he made an offer to buy Wix. And the offer was around $400 million. This is in 2011, right? That was a lot of money. We had just come off the financial crisis of 2008, 9, and 10. Cash was king, you know, and the founder of Wix was like, that's a lot of money. And I think for him, it was something like $65 million just for him. I'm like, ugh, I created this problem by introducing them. And so I took the airplane and I went to Tel Aviv and I told him, I said, I don't think you should sell. He's like, what do you mean? It's $400 million. I told him, I said, I think you're worth multiple billions. And I gave, you know, I spent a whole night and a couple bottles of wine explaining this to him. And at the end, he told me two things. He said, okay, you've sold Skype for $3 billion. I believe you can do it. So I had credibility. That made it easier. And the second one was, he said, I have one condition, is if we take the company public, you sit on the board and you become chairman of the company. Because I don't want to deal with that. And that's how the story happens. So that's really where we make a difference, right? Pushing towards the sale or not. And I'll give you a second example. It's a rather long-winded answer, but I'll give you a second one. We invested in a company in 2010 that was a German equivalent of, you would know the company here, called Privalia, right? And Privalia, they grew, they started about at the same time. My company in Germany was called Brands for Friends. And we did not invest in Privalia at the time because we knew that if we, our thesis at the time was, if somebody's going to come and buy a company like this, it will not be in Spain. That was our thesis. We knew that the American buyers would always go to the biggest market in Europe, and that's Germany. So we invested in Germany, and we sold the company 4 years later. Privalia took another 10 years before they got sold. Right, and so this is a bit what we have to do. We have to worry about timing and exits and all that kind of stuff, and work with the entrepreneurs. You know, so it's a symbiotic relationship as well. Yeah.
Hola, I have a question for you. I think it has a little bit of spikes over there. Transparency.
Yeah.
Transparency. I have a startup in Silicon Valley. Moved 3 years. Over to Spain to start up here, the European division. Huh? And we had a lot of problems with transparency, storytelling and transparency.
Why? You mean your transparency to the market?
To the market, yeah. We tell stories, real stories about the real products. So
okay.
you're talking about healthcare.
Yeah.
And healthcare is transparency, or it should be transparency.
Sure.
And it's the opposite in the US.
Hmm?
So would you invest in a company that is making a lot of money, but is killing people?
No. I can be very clear about that. We have a moral compass in our firm. That moral compass is me in my mirror in front of myself. And I struggle with that. I don't believe that making money is the only thing in life. We have refused to fund a number of companies in the past that were not about killing people. So you'll appreciate where I'm going with this, but rather we're about how could they take advantage of people who were less fortunate. And so a number of years ago, there were a lot of these companies who were supposedly financial services company, who were gonna help people with payday loans. I'll lend you money until your paycheck comes, right? You know, 450% interest rate. And we just couldn't get into that business because I knew that we were taking advantage of people. And so that's our moral compass. We have one. It's true that many investors don't. And that's the magic that you as an entrepreneur and what we have to do is find each other, right? And make sure that we have the same core values about where you're building your business.
Okay, we will talk.
Sure.
thank you. Strictly speaking, I'm not an entrepreneur. I work on product. So your chat was, your speech was really inspiring to me as well. And my company is called 8Belt. We teach online language courses.
Okay.
And it's a little bit in the online e-learning education
yeah.
sector. And my question goes to in which, okay, first of all, what is your vision on education in general, and what kind of tech education company do you think you would be interested in investing?
Yeah. So I would tell you that education, obviously, is a massive space, right? People haven't cracked education yet. They're trying to figure out how you actually build a world-class company around education. There's been issues around how much content you have to produce, the cost of producing that content. That's typically been one of the areas. Of course, in the language space, there's a number of players out there where you can download for free and then you have to pay. And so business model becomes kind of that next question. Commitment becomes the next question, all these typical issues. My guess is we are entering a time frame right now where the concept of the nomad worker is becoming more true than anywhere, than ever. And what I mean by the nomad worker, it's somebody who has a set of skills who says, I'm from Madrid, I don't have to live here. I can go spend 6 months here and 6 months there and 6 months there. And I think the education company that will win will be the one who can figure out how to target that demographic. That demographic is prepared to pay a lot of money because they will always trade off that versus lifestyle. And so there's now a company. It's a hotel chain now, a hotel chain called Selina. I'm not involved in it. Huh? Selina is a small hotel chain, and what they do is they offer these nomad workers the opportunity to also do leisurely activities. And so you'll come and spend 6 months in Mexico at one of their places. Think of it as like WeWork for office space. They're doing it now for you as a nomad worker so that you'll come and live in one of their places and learn how to surf. But take that to the next level, they could also offer all sorts of educational courses. So I would focus on that nomad worker type demographic, would be mine if you're asking that question. Okay, sure. Ah, sorry, over here, you're next.
It's my turn? Okay. Thanks, Mark, for your ability of storytelling. It was really nice. And the most I liked it was your being generous and telling us that one should feel like a bastard if it doesn't share the richness he achieves. So I was lucky enough to live in the United States for 1 year in an American company. I was studying them, but then when I came here in the dot-com explosion, I was able to work in an American company and become related with the stock option plans.
Yep.
And now I'm a CEO and founder of Mentalista. We teach kids to read in a very early stage, at the age of 3.
Okay.
We think like, why give our backs to evolution and not learn our second language the same way we learned the first one,
easily
and with no effort.
Great.
So I became with close to stock options in this company,
yeah.
And I really want to know, because this actually is not very familiar for us, as you say, employers would say, what are you talking to
yeah.
me? So I want to know, how early do you want to put this into the table with your employees? Because you don't want to engage to people that maybe they're not so engaged with the company yet.
Yeah.
And about the amount also. So, this is two questions. Sorry.
Okay, that's fair enough. I mean, I will tell you that, so Guillaume here, who is the CEO of Safe365, I invested seed money into his company. He will tell you that I already talked to him about stock options and the benefits. So I do it very early. I think fundamentally you need to approach the problem very early because you want to hire people who want stock options. I don't want to hire people who just want the cash. You see, the hidden secret is stock options keeps them in my company because if not, they can change tomorrow, right? And as we know, if salary is the only element of your life, you are a bit like a soldier who doesn't work for a government, and that's called a mercenary, right? And so as an employee, you're a mercenary unless you're somehow committed to my vision for a number of years. The tool to commit them is options because they know what they lose if they leave. Right? So we think very early, very early. Oh, the amount? Well, the amount is if you look at, for instance, Wix now, it's a big company, almost 25% of the capital is in options to employees. So that shows you how far you go. That's what you need to do to have 200 millionaires, right, in dollars. It's difficult because that does change depending on the tax regime of each country. So it's very difficult. But, you know, my guess is the more senior the person is, the more that needs to come to 60-40, 60 cash, 40 options. For younger employees who need to rent and those kind of things, it's a bit difficult to do that, right? So there is also a question of level within the company that we would go about, yeah. All right. This guy had a question at the back here. I guess you're next. Go ahead.
Hi. Good afternoon. Thank you very much for your speech and talk. I am Leire Contreras. I work at IBM, and I came with my 13-year-old child. I proposed him to come, and he was really interested in listening to you.
Good.
So my question is, at the beginning, you said that you studied history, and nothing predicts what you are going to finish doing in your real life. The world, you said, companies may change. You look at 10 years term.
Yeah.
Would you think at education, your children, my children, will it work the same rule, no matter what they study, they will be able to?
Well, not no matter what they
say.
Yeah, so no, I think the answer is not no matter what they study. I think that there's a path. It's the path I'm pushing my children, right? I want my children to study the humanities. I want them to study philosophy, history, psychology, because these are lasting skills that you have for your entire life. And I can tell you there's a number of large companies today, maybe even IBM, who are beginning to recognize this and say, I'm not only going to hire engineers all the time, but I'm going to hire real problem solvers. I know a number of companies who have humanities branches. They want to bring people in and do that. So I think, if you ask me, my children are doing this. I'm pushing them towards picking something in the humanities because I know they'll have that analytical skill, right? That thought-provoking capability for the rest of their life. And that, as a parent, is the greatest gift I can give them. Because that is not going to be replaced by a computer any day, right? At least not in the near future. This guy's been waiting for a microphone. Yeah.
Thanks, Mark. I'm Miguel Roncalés from AlphaSip. That's really inspiring because I've been 11 years being an entrepreneur, so I think it's right for momentum.
Cool.
I'm on semiconductor electronics on healthcare. So I want a bit of your view on your crystal ball. How is going to be the tool that is going to replace GP? It's going to be more like a dock phone. It's going to be more a software-based idea. How can you deal with the genomic fluidics?
Yeah,
thanks.
So I think there's a number of paths this takes, right? Most of the companies today are trying to solve the GP problem by pushing you towards a doctor in a way that is using the video or text, these kind of things, but you're still interacting with a human being, right? The problem with that is that it doesn't scale very well, okay? And I think myself, the company I financed, is one that is 100% software-based because it's infinitely scalable, right? I'm having a conversation with a robot that is better, faster, and more accurate than with a human. If you really want to go see a human, you can still use my app, and then you'll go to the doctor, and you'll sound intelligent because, well, you'll know what you have. And people tell me, is that true? I said, well, look, most people today, if you wake up the next tomorrow morning and you have a bit of a pain here or a pain there, the first thing that you do, and don't lie to me because I will know, the first thing that you do is go to Google. And Google only has two answers for you. You have cancer, or you're going to have a heart attack. That's it. So I think the question for me is how do you make that relationship with your doctor better, smarter? And by the way, a lot of doctors, they're also looking at Google, when you're in their office. And so what we're doing now through software and all these other services is demystifying the god that is a doctor. We have thought all these years that they're so brilliant, these doctors. actually, yeah, you know, surgeons are brilliant, but GPs, yeah, they have basic education. They give you antibiotics and some pills, and if not, they send you to a specialist. I'm exaggerating, of course, but this is for the caricature point. And so I think software can just be better and faster at doing that and more efficient. So I think it goes 100% software in some format, right? I mean, Amazon clearly wants to start building this into Alexa. You're at home, Alexa can order you milk, Alexa can diagnose you, right? Potentially, and so on and so forth. So there's gonna be a lot of iterations of this. What I'm sure is it will not be wearables. You know, the problem with wearables is they still need to get much, much better to be accurate. So for any of you who have an Apple Watch, you know, the one that supposedly monitors your heart rate, I can assure you the exactitude of that monitoring is very poor because the technology is complicated to do it in a great manner. So I think if you think about that, you need to think about embedded stuff into the body. And that's coming. That's probably 10 years away. So you see, when we talk about this, you think 5 years? Yeah. So, you know, it's within this time frame, right, that we're going to see software and embedded chips of some format that are going to be able to help you solve these issues in a much, much more efficient way, which is why I said before, if you're kind of above 40 years old, it's like cataracts, you know, the eyes. You don't want to, doctors don't want to operate an 80-year-old of cataract. They say, oh, wait a few more years if it gets worse. You know, well, if it gets worse, you could be dead. So what was the point? And so I think here, you know, there's a big opportunity. Anyway, there we are. It's a long-winded answer.
Ir con el horario.
Hi, Mark.
Hi.
I'm Alexiana. I work at AXA, but I'm here on my
Where?
Own time. At AXA, an insurance company.
Sure, I know AXA very well.
Great.
I'm a client.
Oh, I hope you're well protected. I'm here to help. So my question was, you told us about an example of Job Today.
Yeah.
Now once they started, then there was like 20 other copycats in Europe. And I was wondering, what was their next step? What do you do once you have copycats? Not my, I mean, I work at AXA, I also work at another, we have an e-commerce.
Yeah.
So I'm just...
Well, the first thing you do is freak out.
Yeah.
Because like, oh shit.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. And then you decide you're going to build a better product, you're going to go faster, and you're going to raise more money. That's what you have to do. When your product is copyable, right, and where cash is a great equalizer, then you have to just work faster, execute better, build better product, constantly be innovating around the product, because you know that these other 20 are copying everything that you do. That's all they're doing. There's these companies, all they do is copy. There's a number of companies who just copy Job Today. A new version comes out, boom, you know, 2 months later, the other guys have it too. And so it is a race against time. So the one thing you have to think about when you start a company is, how copyable is this, right? And we worry a lot about that. And today, frankly, technology around some of these apps that you build is pretty easily copyable. So that's a real issue you have to deal with. Okay? Sure.
A ver, yo lo siento muchísimo, pero vamos fatal de tiempo. Así que luego lo intentáis pillar en el networking. Y seguirle haciendo preguntas, lo siento, pero no cumplimos horarios. Bueno, vamos a terminar ya lo que es esta parte, sobre todo más inspiracional de Mark. Os agradecemos una vez más a todos todo el apoyo que siempre nos demostráis a BeStartup del Banco Sabadell. Muchas gracias a todos y hasta el próximo BeStartup Talks.